ourselves to false vendors, we call them amebo. The elders at work say that gossipers are never paid a cent, but only thank you. And after that departure, they look at one another in the face and say, how many of us have scattered other people's homes, places of work, churches and organizations with malicious news and damaging gossips which have no evidence or merit? We see it every day. And we see every day we have a marriage of 20 to 30 years have been torn apart by malicious gossip from husbands, sisters, from wives, best friends, or busybody who have become agents of chaos. May God save us from the evil machinery of these godless people. Amen. Our study of moral virtues will not be complete if we do not also consider the most important tool, our mouth, through which the eyes, the brain, the ear, talk and manifest themselves. From time immemorial, our mouth has also always been a subject of misery and has studied. Even our elders at home used to say that among all the lesser gods to worship, our mouth is the paramount. What can our mouth do to us or for us? Our mouth can build this church.
Amen.
Or can destroy this church.
Amen.
Our mouth can build our country or vice versa. Our mouth can save any marriage or dismantle it. Our mouth can restore or save a lost soul or condemn it. Our mouth can be used to praise God or sin against the Holy Spirit and go to hellfire. Our mouth can also condemn us or save us. Our mouth can promote us to the highest position in life. And our mouth can also send us to prison or send us to the gallows and be hanged or free us from the gallows. And what does the Holy Bible say about our mouth? As we read in Proverbs 16:23, says, a wise man's heart guards his mouth, and his lips promote instruction. A wise man's heart guides his mouth, and his lips promote instruction. When we start considering what our mouth can do for us, we shall be here all day. But because of time, just let us restrict the lessons we have learned from the Holy Bible. In Genesis 18:32-33, it reads, and Abraham said to God, oh, let not the Lord be angry, and I will speak yet but this once, peradventure, then shall be found there in Sodom and Gomorrah, by the way. And the Lord said, I will not destroy Sodom and Gomorrah for their sake. And the Lord went his way, as soon as he had left communion with Abraham, and Abraham returned unto his palace. Abraham nearly saved Sodom and Gomorrah from destruction. But Abraham could not produce 10 righteous men from the whole nation of Sodom and Gomorrah. No, except his nephew Lot, his two daughters, and his reluctant wife. I hope you youths know the story of Sodom and Gomorrah. And then how did Esau lose his birthright? How did Esau lose his birthright? In Genesis 25:31-33, and Jacob said, sell me this day thy birthright. Sell me this day thy birthright. And Esau said, behold, I am at the point to die. And what profit shall this birthright do to me? And Jacob said, swear to me this day. And he swore unto him, and he sold his birthright unto Jacob. for a pot of porridge. Esau used his mouth to say out his birthright, and he paid miserably for it. 3. In Genesis 27, 28 to 22, Isaac, after eating the delicious venison that his son Jacob prepared, and succeeded in deceiving their father. Isaac said, therefore, God give thee of the dew of heaven and the fatness of the earth and plenty of corn and wine. Let people serve thee and nations bow down to thee. Be Lord over thy brethren and let thy mother's son bow down to you. Cursed be everyone that cursed thee, and blessed be he that cursed thee. Now, let me go over that again. For the sake of this youth, if you have forgotten the story of Isaac's children, Esau and Jacob. Esau was the firstborn. Then came Jacob. And in those days, it's traditional that the firstborn inherits the leadership of the house. So when Isaac died, Esau should become the head of the house to take command. But God had a different plan. Because Esau was fornicating with the Canaanites. He was not ready, did not make himself a useful vessel to God, and God was not ready to use him. But Jacob was ready to be used by God. So, there was division in the family. Isaac loved his firstborn, Esau. And the other loved Jacob very well. And the mother now overheard the father telling Esau, I'm about to die. Go and hunt for a venison, a bush meat for me. Cook it the way you used to cook it so I can enjoy, I can eat it. After I've eaten it, then I will bless thee. Now, Esau was a man of the field. He has ears all over his body. All over his body. And Jacob was not. Jacob has smooth skin. And he doesn't smell like sheep. Because Esau was looking after the sheep. So now, Rebecca now told Jacob, your father is about to bless your brother. Go and get one of the firstborn of the sheep. Let me cook it for you and take it to your father so that you can receive the blessing. He said, man, how can I do that? Even though my father could not see, but he will touch my skin. He will know that I'm not Esau. He will hear my voice, he will smell me. He will curse me. No, I can't do that. The mother said, no, don't worry. It is God's design. Don't worry, if God is with us, nothing will happen to us. Just have faith. Just do what I say. So Isaac brought the meat, they cook it. And then the mother had to cover his body with goat skin. His hands with goat skin. So Jacob took the meat to his father, who could not see. And Isaac said, is that you, Esau, my son? He said, yes, it's me, father. He said, but the voice sounded like Jacob. Come nearer to me. So he came nearer to the father. The father looked at his hand. It was hairy because he covered his hand with goat skin. He smelled him, it was goat skin. So he must be truly Esau. So he ate the food, he enjoyed it. He enjoyed it. And they said, let me bless you. So that blessing is the meaning of the birthright. I want you to listen to that blessing again now. Isaac said in Genesis 27, 28, therefore, God give thee of the dew of heaven. God will give you the one I'm blessing. I don't know whether it's Esau or Jacob, but I presume it's Esau. God will give you the dew of heaven. God will give you the fatness of the earth and plenty of corn and wine. And let people serve thee, and nation will bow down to thee. You will be Lord over thy brethren. Jacob, you will be Lord over your senior brother Esau. Which he did not mean to say. And let your mother's son bow down to thee. Cursed be everyone that calls thee. And blessed be he that blessed thee. So he has stamped it. He has given him his blessing. He has poured out all the blessings from his belly. Brethren, please take note. And let us be very, very careful with our mouth. So that we shall not end up condemning ourselves. Another one. What did poor shepherd boy David say when he confronted the Philistine, the Goliath? And I'm sure most of our youth also must have read the story of David and the Goliath. But if you have not read it or don't understand it, go there today. It's in 1 Samuel chapter 17. Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword, and with a spear, and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day, will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee, and take thy head from thee, and I will give the carcass of your host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air, and to the wild beasts of the earth, and all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with the sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord. And he will give you into my hand. God's new church, we move to a new church. Not by our own struggle. The battle is the Lord. Amen. At his right time, he will do it. Because he is God of possibilities. And we must hold fast to our faith.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So how can our mouth condemn us? How can our mouth condemn us? There was a young man that ran from the battlefield where King Saul was killed by the Philistines to report to David. This young man, he saw that King David was smitten by the Philistines and killed, as well as his son Jonathan, by the enemies. He was standing far off, he saw it. He ran to David because he knew that David and Saul were enemies. I mean, they didn't agree. So he thought, if I tell David that I killed his enemy, I killed King Saul, he will make me a rich man. And the Bible tells us in 2 Samuel 1 to 10 or 1:10 say, so I stood upon him and I slew him because I was sure that he could not live after that he was fallen. And I took the crown that was upon his head, and the breastplate that was on his arm, and I brought them hither unto my Lord. He was boasting that he killed King Saul for David, and he brought a crown and the breastplate to the Lord. And how was the young lad rewarded for the report he has just delivered? How was he rewarded? Can anybody tell me? David has a young man standing by to kill him, that brought the report instead of compensating him with the riches. In verse 16, David said, thy blood be upon thy head, for thy mouth has testified against thee, saying, I have slain the Lord's anointed. I have slain the Lord's anointed. How can you, whom God has blessed, let no man curse? And 6, in the New Testament, when Ananias kept back part of the money, he sold the land. I hope very soon Our Bible teacher will bring us the story of Ananias. Apostle Peter asked Sapphira, his wife, in Acts Apostle 5:8. And Peter answered unto her, "Tell me, whether ye sold the land for so much?" And this is a story of Ananias and Sapphira. For the benefit of our youth too, in those days, after Jesus ascended to heaven, the disciples gathered together and everybody selling their property, bringing all the proceeds to the Christian brothers, and they were sharing it, feeding the poor. And Ananias and Sapphira, they sold their own land too. And like most of us, they said, "Oh, wait a minute, am I going to give them all this? I sold this thing for $100,000 and I'm going to give the whole $1,000 to these people." He said, "No, let us give them 60,000 and keep back 40,000.